Pastor Faith. He's the very wise God, and there's absolutely none like him. We serve a good God, and he's worthy to be praised. Just for the atmosphere, somebody come to that and shout hallelujah. And say, neighbor, we're going to put the devil on the run today. Every time we give God a praise, that devil won't back up. He's going to back up. He's going to back up. He's going to run. I see the devil packing up his bags already. In the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. Saints, it gives me great honor to stand before this sacred desk. Amongst many men and women of God, the saints of God that are here on today, we thank you for pressing your way to come out to the grace place. You could have chosen to go anywhere else, but you've come here to the grace place to shout, dance, and become delivered from whatever it is you're challenged with. Uh-huh. I believe that today that the revival is going to break out of your life today. I ain't got no help in here yet. I said the revival is going to break out. Your life today, our revival is going to happen today. There may be some things that was dead in your life, but God is going to revive those things. I wish I had a witness in the house. God is going to revive you today. After today, you'll never be the same again. I don't care how heavy the burden may be, or how tough, or how challenging it may be. The God we serve is able to do exceeding abundantly. Without further ado, we have this man of God that's going to share with us and going to minister to us the word of God all the way from Chicago, Illinois. This man of God not only serves as the assistant pastor at his church, One Way Christian Center under the pastorate of Suffolk Bishop Nicholson, but he also serves as the chairman, president of the IPYPU, Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, saints and friends. If you do not know, this man of God is a national evangelist that has preached all over this entire world.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He has preached and been called out by many bishops to preach in their church. But we are honored to have him amongst us on today. He has taken our time of his busy schedule to grace us. Our relationship is growing, our friendship is growing, and God is blessing. He has a beautiful family, he has a beautiful wife back in Chicago, Illinois. And we're grateful that the Lord allowed him to get through the snow, hello somebody, through the ice, and through prayers to be here on today. Saints, if I can ask you graciously to just stand to your feet. And if you can just do this, I know you're standing, but if you can do this and just act like you got a seatbelt and fasten your seatbelt. Because it's time for takeoff.
Amen. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It is time for takeoff.
Yes.
I bring to this podium the man of God, our very own, Elder Jared Perdue, as he comes. As the Lord Almighty hand brings all over his sanctuary. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Before you take your seat, you to connect and let's grab hands all over the sanctuary. Sometimes we don't understand the significance of our touch. Sometimes we don't understand the power of touch, the power of agreement. There's some of us in the house today who haven't had a pleasant touch all week long. Some of us have been degraded and belittled and put down all week. Been disrespected on our jobs, talked about at school, disrespected in your home. But you want to understand, when you come in the grace place, you're in a safe place.
Yes, sir!
Look at somebody and just say, you're in a safe place.
You're in a safe place.
And I want you to intercede, because maybe no one prayed for them all week, but I need them to know that today somebody's praying for them. I want you to squeeze their hands on both sides, and I need you to holler to heaven on your brother and sister's behalf. Father, we thank you today, because you've been a mighty God to us. There is no one like you, God, none beside you, none above you, God, none even below you. We glorify you, for in you we live, move, and have our being. God, we thank you because you got us through
the inclement weather. You got us, God, through a rough week. You got us through the ups and downs and the turbulence of life. I thank you because we're here today. You've graced us to come to the safe place. You've graced us, God, to come to lift your name and give you glory. Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters whose hands I hold. I decree and declare, God, whatever they've been praying for, it shall come to pass. You know the financial situation they have. You know the emotional struggle they have. You know the mental fight that they have. I pray, God, that the Holy Ghost has his way in their life. I pray, God, you do exceeding and abundantly above, that this day be the first day of the rest of their blessed life. And I decree whatever they need, that they begin to see it manifest, not tomorrow, God, but right now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. I need you to squeeze their hand and declare that name that's above every name and say, in the name of Jesus. I need you to say it like you got apostolic Holy Ghost power. In the name of Jesus. Somebody say, it is so. It is so. Somebody say, it is done. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, give God a mighty praise if you believe that they already got for you. Hallelujah. God is good to us. Nobody like him, nobody near him. Please be seated in his presence. And we are all here today because God has been gracious to us. God has been wonderful to us. God has been merciful to us. We're all here because of his mercies that endure forever. They endureth forever. ETH endureth forever. Do it forever. I don't know about you, but I understand the only reason I'm here is because God has been merciful to me. Not because I've always made the right decisions. Not because I've always hung out with the right people. Not because I've always showed up at the right place. Truth be told, and I know I'm not by myself, you say it, so you ain't got to say it, I'll say it for you. You didn't always say the right thing. You didn't always go to the right place. And you sure didn't always hang out with the right people. But look at you today, looking saved and sanctified and Holy Ghost filled, and God has blessed you. God has blessed you and I not to look like what we've been through. I could shout off that. I could rejoice off that. If people really knew your testimony, if people really knew the things that you struggled with and the things you've gone through in your life, they might change their seat. They might move because there is no resemblance of what you have gone through that is manifested in how you look today. And that's a God that preserves us. He didn't allow the devil to whoop up on us too bad to where people could see and identify where we came from. So I'm so glad God has graced us to be here and not look like the things that the devil tried to use to kill us. And because of that, I owe him a praise. I owe him a hallelujah. I owe him a thank you, Jesus. Not because of the Mercedes, and not because, and that's nice, I love Mercedes, but not because of the Mercedes, not because of the new house. That's wonderful, I'll take that as well. But simply because I didn't wake up in hell this morning. Anybody glad they didn't wake up in hell today? I know. And so that's why we give him the glory, we give him the honor, and we give him the praise. So we honor the Lord for this wonderful angel in this house, the set man for such a time as this. Help me celebrate our illustrious leader, our wonderful pastor, our brother. Give God mighty praise. For the wonderful Pastor David Johnson. Come on, give some Holy Ghost love for our pastor. Say, we love you, Pastor. It's wonderful. Love on leadership. Love on your leadership. Leadership is a thing that sometimes when we have good leadership, we take it for granted. Because it's good leadership and you just think that's the expectation everywhere. And there are some places open today that don't have good leadership. And so God has graced this place with such a man who has given us good leadership. He is relevant to the time. There's nothing worse than watching somebody who is outdated. Time is far spent. I'm an NBA fan, and sometimes I don't know. Are we on Periscope right now? Maybe I shouldn't say this thing. I don't know. I love Kobe Bryant. This week, I enjoyed him. I like Kobe Bryant because he reminds me a lot of the greatest player of all time, which is Michael Jordan. And so when Jordan retired, I stopped watching basketball for a while. And then Kobe just resembled him so much that I got back into the game. But as much as I like Kobe Bryant, I'm looking at him and I'm like, man, I don't know, Kobe, maybe it's time to hang it up. I don't want to. But nothing is worse than looking at somebody whose time is far spent. But God has blessed us with a leader who is relevant to the time. He's making major moves in the kingdom.
Yes.
And the things that God has in store, or rather downloaded into him, that he's going to reveal to the ministry is magnificent. So this ain't the time to leave the church.
Amen.
It's not time to leave the church. It's the time to get on board.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Stir up your gift. Stir up your anointing. Because he said, buckle up your seatbelt because grace is getting ready to take off. So thank God for Pastor. Appreciate him. Bible declares, two shall become one. And so, listen, we cannot just honor our pastor and not give that same honor to his lovely wife, the first lady of his house. Our friend, the preacher must change. First Lady Johnson said, we love you, First Lady. We honor her for her, and just wonderful tag team ministry, the entire First Family, all of God's people that are here, certainly all of our preachers, elders, evangelists, those young people that sung, they did a tremendous job singing the gospel. They got up here. It takes courage to get up here. Do you all know that? That takes courage. That takes courage to come up here and look at people and speak to them. That takes courage because y'all can have some expressions on y'all face sometimes. Make a brother just want to quit. I ain't doing this no more. So it takes courage. And so they got up there and they did a wonderful job. And they're here in the house of the Lord. Statistically, one statistic says every 2 hours, 150 young people die. Every 2 hours. So from the time of the beginning of the service to the conclusion of the service, statistics say 150 will be dead. I'm so glad that those young people will not be in the statistic. Because they're in the grace place. So I want you to celebrate those young people. I want you to celebrate them. If you don't celebrate them, there's a pack out there that will. Okay, so we got to celebrate. We got to celebrate and love God for what he's doing in them. That would be what I said. I said, if you don't celebrate them, there's a pimp out there that will. There's a gang out there that will. There's a drug dealer that will celebrate them. And so we want to celebrate our young people. I know we appreciate what you're doing. We're glad you're in the house of the Lord, singing for the Lord. I came up in the church. I'm a Pentecostal pew baby, born and raised in. I was coming to church even before I was physically manifested. My mama was pregnant, bringing me to choir rehearsal. She was the choir director, so I was there. So we appreciate them and the gift that they have. All right, I'm not gonna be a long time. I just have something to say that the Lord has given me. There's an assignment from the Lord. Matthew chapter 26, verse 36. Matthew 26, verse 36. 26 and 36. I think the enemy was trying to keep me in Chicago today. They canceled my flight yesterday after being at the airport for about 3 hours. Then they rescheduled it for this morning, so I left my house at about 4 this morning, 4:30, to get to the airport because my flight was at 7:15. Got to the airport on time, sitting on the plane, and the wheels were frozen. The wheels were frozen, so we're supposed to take off at 7:15. And they said, well, we gotta thaw the wheels before we can take off. And that was at 7:15. When I woke up at about 9:30, we were still sitting there. And I was like, Lord, I need you to calm my nerves. Just calm me down. And I prayed and said, if I'm to be there, then you'll make a way. If he has to snap his finger and get me here, through transition in the spirit realm, whatever he got to do to get me here. And I said, and if I'm not to be there, then calm me, just calm me down so that I won't be so anxious. But we thank the Lord that it was his will that we be here.
Yeah.
So I'm so glad. So I need y'all to pray for me. All right. I got Holy Ghost power and a 5-hour energy drink working right now. So I need y'all to pray. All
right.
All right. Where I say turn to? Y'all ready? Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go pray yonder. And he took with Peter, and he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh again unto the disciples and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Well,
he went away again a second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And all of God's people said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. You can be seated in his presence. I want to say this very quickly. We want to be careful, especially living in this Western world. We want to be mindful and careful as preachers and ministers of the gospel, those that witness this tremendous gospel of Jesus Christ. We want to be careful not to allow the calendar of the Western world determine what God has assigned for us to minister. And so what I mean by that is, if we minister only according to the calendar of the Western world, we would only preach about the birth of Christ during Christmas time. And we know the birth of Christ, not only is it good in December, but it's also good in July. And so we don't want to go with the Western world calendar is saying to dictate what we ought to be saying in the spirit realm. And I mentioned that because this is a text that ordinarily is preached around Resurrection Sunday. And we're nowhere near Easter, but God said, I want you to talk about me today, all right? Just I want to talk about Jesus for a little bit today. I want to talk about his passion released the power. His passion released the power. Help me preach. Look at somebody and say, he did it for me. He did it for me. He did it for me. He, Jesus, he did it for me. It is imperative, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, that we note and recognize that our salvation that we obtain today, and rather the salvation also that has been made available to us today, it is imperative that you and I understand it has only been made available through the strict obedience of one named Jesus Christ. The salvation that we rejoice in, the salvation that we're thankful for has been made available to us because Jesus Christ was obedient. It's in Romans 5:19, he declares, for as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Understand, people of God, young people, brothers and sisters, understand that Jesus was always fully aware of what his ultimate mission was. Jesus was always fully aware. He had an understanding, at least at the age of understanding, he was fully aware of what his ultimate mission was. And he did not mind ever explaining to people what his ultimate mission was if they were ever unclear as to why he came. If Jesus was doing something and somebody tried to get him to do something else, just a little bit more in the monitors is good. If they tried to get him to do something else, Jesus did not mind explaining to them why I'm here. Jesus used the term that I like to call intentional language. Everybody say intentional language. statement. Jesus always used intentional language for anybody who was unclear as to, that's good, as to why he came to earth. I want you to understand, it's in Luke 2:49, Jesus used intentional language. He looked at them and said, "Wist ye not that I must be about my Father's business?" It's in Matthew 12:50, he again uses intentional language. They came to the house where Jesus was, and they said, "Jesus, your mama outside, your brothers and sisters, they are outside, and they can't get in because of the multitude of people." And it is Jesus here who just denounced name dropping in this particular passage. He just denounced the name dropping, because sometimes people feel like they can get in the door based on who they know in the house. And Jesus used intentional language and said, "Who is my mother? Who is my brothers? Whosoever does the will of my Father, that's my mother, that's my brother, that's my sister." It is in John 2:4. He again uses intentional language, and he looks at his mother, not to be disrespectful, but he looks at his mother and says, "Woman, what have I to do with thee? My hour has not yet come." I didn't come down here to keep the party going just to change water to wine. My hour, or rather, the ultimate reason of why I have come has not shown up yet. I don't want you to think that Jesus is just a great party planner. No, no, no. What I came for, it's not time, or that hour has not yet come. It is again in John 2:19. Jesus uses intentional language, and he says, "If you destroy this temple," he said, "in 3 days, I will raise it up." Not that I'm going to try to do it. I hope to God I have the strength to do it. He said, "Destroy this temple." I'm giving you intentional language of what's going to happen in 3 days after this temple is destroyed. I will raise it up. Notice there, ladies and gentlemen, it is his obedience that was intentional. Now, his obedience was intentional because the atonement was a necessity. Everybody say necessity. His obedience was intentional, or it was on purpose, because the atonement was a necessity. Now, just for a few more minutes, let's consider the atonement. Now, the atonement, it was not a necessity because God needs to save us in order for him to keep his God status, all right? The atonement is not a necessity because God needs to save you and I so that he can remain God. No, no. It's not a necessity for him to remain who he is to save us, but rather it is a necessity as a consequence of God's choice to save us. The atonement becomes a necessity as a consequence of God's choice to save us. Some theologians, they will call it the consequent absolute necessity. It's the consequent absolute necessity. In other words, my dear brothers and my dear sisters, when God in his love, God is love, so when God in his love chose to save us, he understood the only way he could save us was through the death of Jesus the Christ. Jesus says here, God says, I love them, and because I'm choosing to love them, the only way that I can save them whom I love is that Jesus dies for them. He chose to love us. And I don't know about y'all, but I'm still excited about God choosing to love me. Some of us, we didn't got good and we got our stuff together, and somewhere along the line, some folk feel like they deserved God's love. But the truth of the matter is, when God found you and I, none of us looked like we look right now, right? Can I tell you how you looked when God found you? Can I show you? It's in Ezekiel 16:6. He says, "When I found you," he said, "you were polluted in your own blood." When I found you, you, you were stank. When I found you, nobody wanted to touch you. When I found you, you were choking and dying on your own blood. Everybody else walked past you. Everybody else said, ugh, look at that. Do you smell that? That is disgusting. But when God passed by you and I, he looked at us polluted in our own blood, and he said, I want to love you. There's nothing attractive about you and I, nothing appealing about you and I. He just looked at us and said, I want to love you. And so then, because he loved us, not because we were attractive, it was just something in him that wanted to pull us out of the situation that we were in. And because he loved us, his love made it necessary to save us, all right? Don't you tell me how much you love me, but you can never do anything for me. Don't tell me how much you love me, but you don't ever want to sacrifice for me. Love must be something greater than the conclusion of a Hallmark card that you put on the bottom. Love takes action. And I need you to do something if you declare that you love me. And Jesus is saying here, God loved you so much that he said, I have to save them. But as a consequence to save you, Jesus has to die for you. As a consequence, if I'm going to save you because I love you, Jesus, you have to die for them. And so then, it is Jesus now who must become the propitiation. I need y'all to help me preach. Everybody say propitiation. We got a good class today, propitiation. It is Jesus who becomes the propitiation now that changed God's wrath toward us into God's favor toward us, all right? It is Jesus who is standing. He changes God's wrath toward us into God's favor toward us. I don't know about you, but I thank God for Jesus. I thank God for Jesus. I thank God for being sending Jesus to be the propitiation for man so that we may receive the favor of God. Now, there is an argument here. There are some who believe, even theologians, there are some who believe that they have dismissed Jesus from becoming the propitiation, or they have dismissed Jesus as being the go-between between God and man. They do not deny the presence of Jesus. They do not deny that Jesus existed, but rather they deny his role and assignment in the earth realm when it comes to God changing his wrath into favor. Their argument is this. They say Jesus could not be the propitiation because if he was, then this would be inconsistent with the character of God. They say Jesus cannot be the propitiation because it would be inconsistent with who God is in character. Remember? They said God is a loving Father. God, he's a loving God. He's a loving Father. And they said it's inconsistent with his character for God, who is a loving Father, to want to have wrath against that which he has created. They said, that's not like God. Why would God create man from the dust of the earth and breathe pneuma into man's nostrils and man become a living flesh, and then God want to turn around and destroy man? They said it's inconsistent. He's a loving God. He is a loving Father. So because God is a loving Father, Jesus is not necessary to be a propitiation to shift God from wrath to favor. Now, let's remember, my dear brothers and sisters, that there is an eternal and unchangeable requirement in the holiness and justice of God, that wherever sin is, there is a price that must be paid. All right, y'all stay with me just a few no minutes here. It's unchangeable in the holiness and justice of God. Whenever sin shows up, God has his hand out and says, somebody owes me a payment because there is sin in the camp. Whenever sin shows up, God is looking for blood as a payment for the sin. And even though God is a loving Father, he is a loving God, if Jesus does not become the propitiation, then this loving Father would be forced to love you and I to death. All right? If Jesus does not step in, God is forced to love us to death. He's forced to love us to the grave. He's forced to love us to hell, because there is a payment that is required. And his word declares the wages of sin is death. And God is saying, where is my money? Where is my payment? Somebody owes me something because I have identified sin. And so then Jesus must become the compromise. Jesus must be the compromise between God and man. And so then it is Jesus who is the compromise that declares, I come that you might have life and life more abundantly. It is Jesus who is the solace. He's pulling God and he's pulling man back together again. It is Jesus who looks at God, and Jesus said, God, don't get them for it. Jesus says, get me for it. Oh, God, help me in here. He's pulling us and reconciling us back together again. So then, since Christ is the solace, Jesus must live a perfect life of obedience, because he is the propitiation, because he is the compromise, because he is the solace, then Jesus must live a perfect life of obedience in order to earn righteousness for you and I. I hope y'all don't mind me talking about Jesus a little bit today. We can talk about money, cars, and all of that, but I want to talk about Jesus just for a few more minutes here. And Jesus now has to be perfect in obedience so that you and I can earn righteousness unto God. We get our righteousness from him being obedient. So now we all need Jesus to resist every temptation of the devil so that you and I may have a chance at salvation. I said we need Jesus to resist every temptation. We don't need Jesus to have an oops moment. No. We don't need Jesus to say, well, God knows my heart. No, Jesus. We don't need Jesus to slip up every now and then because you know I'm in the flesh. No, Jesus, we need you to hold it together. We need you, Jesus, to resist the devil every time he shows up, because every time the devil shows up and you resist him, you are earning righteousness for somebody that's in the grace place. Oh God, I wish I could preach to some real folk. Give me a little bit more of those monitors. I wish you would realize the only reason any of us are sitting here right now is because Jesus had the power to say no to the devil. Oh God, I want to run a little bit. I'm running a little bit. Jesus, we need you to resist the devil on every hand. Jesus, when the devil shows up and he comes to you and he says, take these stones and turn them to bread. Jesus, you got to resist the devil. If you take the stones and turn them to bread, then Jesus, we will never be able to call you the bread of life. We need you to resist him when he comes to you and say, cast yourself down at the request of the enemy. When the devil says, cast yourself down, you know the angels are going to come and show up and keep you from hitting the ground. If Jesus listens to the and cast himself down, then none of us in here can cast our cares upon him. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. If Jesus takes the offer that the devil is trying to give him, when the devil says, if you just bow to me, if you would just bow in my presence, I will give you the kingdoms of this world. And the text would suggest to us that when Satan asks Jesus to bow, he is not asking him to lay out before him. All the devil wanted Jesus to do was posture himself forward just a little bit. He just wanted Jesus just to bow a little bit. You ain't got to go all the way over, Jesus, just a little bit. And ain't that just like the devil? Just have a little drink. Just smoke you a little weed. Just go over her house for a little while. I had some real folk in this house. If you go forward just a little bit, he said, I'll give you the kingdoms of this world. But if Jesus bows for the kingdoms of this world, then you and I can never declare that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Your neighbor and say it belongs to God. That's why his word declares that as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. That's why, my dear brothers and sisters, today as I hurry to a close, that's why we cannot treat our salvation like a simple act in history, like anybody could have saved you from your sins. That's why we cannot reduce our salvation to Holy Ghost holidays. We cannot reduce our salvation and only want to celebrate it on Pentecost Sunday. We cannot minimize our salvation as a simple act that happened a long time ago. Because the truth of the matter is, if it had not been for Jesus, none of us would be sitting up in this room today. But I feel like preaching a little bit. Jesus understood, and he already knew, I'm getting ready to go through a struggle. But I'm so glad that 2,000 years ago, he looked forward into time, and he saw you and I sitting in the grace place, and he said, I cannot give up, because somebody in there is worth fighting for. Oh God, I feel like running. Give your neighbor a high five and declare, neighbor, tell him, I don't care what the devil said, Jesus said, you're worth fighting for. God, lift up your head, O ye gates. Get away from here, low self-esteem. Get away from here, depression. Get away from here, suicide. He died for me. God, I got to run, y'all. But I'm so convinced, y'all, that Jesus loved me so much that if I was the only human being that existed on the face of the earth, he would have went through all the trouble just to save my life. Give your neighbor a high five and declare, he did it for me. Oh God, he did it for me. That's why some of us still sitting there. I don't know if she got a little bit more push she can give me. Give me all you got here. I don't know if we understand the significance, that's it, of what we got from Jesus. Maybe that's why some of us come in this house and we don't clap and we don't open our mouth, because we don't understand the significance of what Jesus had to go through to save your black soul. I'm talking about the sin, black darkness of your soul. Shake your neighbor,
his hand and say, he did it for me. What did he do for me? Well, Jesus had to go through the psychological agony of seeing visions of his bloody death. Jesus had to go through knowing that he is omniscient. He had to see what he was getting ready to go through. I don't know about y'all today, but it's got to be agony to have the ability to look into the future of what you're getting ready to go through in your life. Jesus had to conquer what some psychologists declare are the five reactions to impending death. In other words, brothers and sisters, psychologists declare to us that when you know you're getting ready to die, there are five phases that your mind and body goes through when you got impending death coming. When you know you're getting ready to leave this world, you go through five phases. Can we talk about the five, y'all? It's in Matthew chapter 26, and it starts at verse 36. In verse 36, psychologists declare the first phase is the phase of isolation. Let me hear the church say isolation. In verse 36, Jesus said, sit ye here while I go yonder and pray for a little bit. I don't know if you've ever been there where you had to get off of Facebook, had to shut down your Twitter account, had to turn your phone off and said, I'm going through something in my life that I need Jesus to get me out of. And you go to your prayer closet, you shut the door and say, if I'm gonna get out of this one, I need the Lord. Have you ever isolated yourself? He went through isolation. Then in verse 38, he went through the second phase. The second phase is depression. Verse 38 declares that Jesus spoke and said, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Jesus had to fight against psychological depression. Jesus was struggling. Have you ever been there where you felt like the devil came and sat on your shoulder? Have you ever been there? I know you saved up in here, but I need some real folk that have had to shake themselves and say, get off of me, devil. Oh God, I feel like running. It was Jesus here. He said, my soul is fighting depression. What is his soul? It's his mind. It's his will. It's his imagination. His intellect. And his emotions. He was fighting to stay sane. He was fighting to not give up. Who was he fighting for? Look at your neighbor and say, me. He was fighting for me. Then the Bible declares that he went to the third phase. Psychologists declare, after isolation, after bargaining, the third phase is bargaining. Isolation, depression, then bargaining. Verse 39 declares that Jesus said, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup, let it pass from me. I don't want to drink from it because I know what's in the cup. I don't want to deal with it because I know what's in the cup. And you can find another way to save the folk that you love. Let's make a deal, God. 1 hour. The fourth phase is an anger. Jesus got mad because the same folk that said, I'll never leave you, are sleep on them. The same folk that declared, I got your back, they nodded off at the most turbulent time in his life. You got the unmitigated goal to be sitting up here asleep. Have you ever been there when you're going through trouble and you call your prayer partner? They don't answer the phone. They call you the next day and say, oh, I'm sorry, I was asleep. I feel like running. You gotta get to a place where you can look at folk and say, sleep on. You ain't got to stay awake. As a matter of fact, give them a pillow and say, take your rest, because I found strength in the Lord God Almighty. Because he declared,
in the garden. around undefeated. He went through the five phases just for me. What does the number five mean? Grace. He went through the grace. God gave him the grace to go through it. He suffered everything you and I would go through psychologically. Somebody in an abusive relationship, so was Jesus. They beat him. You're in a verbally abusive relationship, so was Jesus. They talked about him, they cursed him. You got people belittling you in your life, so did Jesus. They said, if you're the king of the Jews, save yourself. You can't even get down from him. And through it all, he said, they're worth it. Even the people that's beating me, they're worth me dying for. Even the people that won't clap their hands in church, he said, they're worth dying for. Even the people that won't open up their mouth and say, thank you, Jesus, he said, they're worth it, worth dying for. He said, and if I die, I can release the power to them. You got the Holy Ghost not just to shout and dance. You have the Holy Ghost so that you can simply respond like Jesus did. When they beat him, talked about him, criticized him, belittled him, you got the power to open up your mouth like Jesus did and say, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. He gave me his power. Jesus is necessary. You know, that's the ultimate job of the devil. It's not to take your job. The ultimate job of the devil is not to get your car repossessed or for your home to go in foreclosure. The ultimate job of the devil is to make Jesus irrelevant in your life. That's what he wants to do. He said, I need to make Jesus irrelevant. That's what the devil wants to do. I need you to know that Jesus is not necessary in your everyday life. When the scripture declares, it's in him that I live, move, and have my being. He said, if I can make Jesus irrelevant, you won't live, you won't move, you won't have your being. So he's trying to remove Jesus. Jesus said, you were worth fighting for, and I did it for you. Just wanted to talk about this man that did it for you, that died for you. I want you to know today, I'm rushing to a close. I want you to know today, if you don't have the Holy Ghost, you will receive it today if you come down here.